special called meeting of the Bristol Virginia City Council today, Tuesday, March 8th, 2022. Please join us for a moment of silence. Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance. Okay, for our special called meeting today, we will adopt our agenda first. There's just one item on it. What's the pleasure of the council?
I move for the adoption of the agenda.
Second.
A motion and a second. Clerk, please call the roll.
Hartley?
Yes.
Knave?
Yes.
Osborne?
Yes.
Wingard?
Yes.
Farnham?
Yes. Item one of our called meeting is budget workshop. Staff discussion.
Tonight is our first budget workshop of the 22-23 fiscal year, and we're going to start out with goals that council has submitted to me for this upcoming budget cycle. So one council member says landfill is top priority, continue to do what we need to do to fix the problem. Second, reserve fund, protect and maintain the reserve funds. The city has been working hard for the past several years to build these reserve funds, and I do not believe this council member wants those funds to be spent unless absolutely necessary. Third, CVB, funding for the CVB. Tourism is a revenue generator, and we need to put more funding into our CVB office so they have the resources they need to market the city. They need funding to apply for grants that require a match, and this could double our investment. And BCM, funding owed per an agreement from a few years ago. Next, city employees, retaining employees. We need to make sure that we are focusing on employee retention for our city employees by offering growth and training opportunities. Add a position for PR and communications and fill vacant positions ASAP. Specifically, as it relates to Discover Bristol and BCM, fund those agencies $175,000 and $100,000 apiece. And then hire the public information officer, which was also listed under 4B. Next, a council member wants to institute a pay raise for city employees. We've seen consistently across all departments that it's hard to retain quality employees without paying them a competitive wage. This has been very apparent in the police and fire departments specifically. Our employees work hard and they should be compensated fairly. Increase in budgeted spending for landfill repair and maintenance. As is readily apparent, we should have more money in the solid waste disposal fund budget for ongoing repairs and maintenance. We've done a good job approving these requests as supplemental appropriations, but having them budgeted will make the process move more quickly. Begin fixing secondary roads. While many of our larger thoroughfares are VDOT maintained, roads in neighborhoods and side streets are in the need of repair, including patching potholes. These are a safety issue and a plan needs to be in place to fix them. Four, outside agencies. We need to reassess the levels at which we fund our outside agencies. I understand appropriations were reduced due to COVID, but the city has weathered the pandemic fairly well, and it's time to begin gradually increasing appropriations to these groups that do important work. Bonus, while it may not be possible this fiscal year, we need a yearly plan to lower the real estate tax rate and decrease the tax burden on our citizens. We anticipate increased revenues over the next several years, and even if we reduce the real estate tax, we'll still realize greatly increased revenues. Next, don't increase the trash rate. More funding to our first responders, police and fire, in the form of pay raises to help with hiring and retention. Three, lower the real estate tax rate. Finally, goal number one, maintain the city's recent progress in its financial position by utilizing conservative database budget estimates, maintain a structurally balanced budget, continue to set aside funds to anticipate increased debt payments, continue to maintain reserves and build up our cash reserves to enable the city to mitigate potential risk, both known and unforeseen. Continue to implement the capital plan using one-time funding for large needs while setting aside a portion of recurring revenues to deal with recurring needs. Goal number two, the landfill solid waste disposal fund. Budget for the continued work to eliminate the landfill gas odors as quickly as possible. Budget necessary funding for continued monitoring budget for the study of the feasibility of early closure of the landfill. Number three, personnel, ensure the retention and attraction of talented individuals by providing pay increases, especially for essential government functions that are difficult to fill, police, fire, and collection disposal. Reinstate positions to the budget, including a separate city attorney, a public information officer, sufficient non-compensation board funding to provide for courthouse security. Conduct a salary study to institute a fair, equitable, and market-based compensation scale with various steps for all city employees in future budget cycles. And goal number four, strategic investments that will prepare the city for future growth. Adequately funding tourism initiatives for the market the city, resulting in increasing revenues from the meals and lodging taxes. Fund any necessary road improvements to create adequate access for the new school project. Conduct a study to develop a long-term master plan for the development of recreational spaces in Bristol, specifically development at Sugar Hollow Park. And finally, conduct a study to determine the best use for current and future vacant city-owned buildings. So that was the goals set forth by council this year. We've already incorporated some of those in our budget planning as we've gone throughout the budget process so far. We will continue to look at your goals. Some of your goals may be realized, others may not, just based on the financial situation of the city, but we'll do our best to make sure that we can try to reach every one of those goals that we possibly can. So any questions or comments amongst council members about specific goals?
Well, one comment, and I'll just kick it off. And the way I understand it, this is open for any of us to discuss and comment, kind of an open conversation. Some of the things I saw at least once, maybe a couple times, was from several folks about the landfill. Obviously, that's a big priority. And then I saw a few things in there about pay for employees, which hopefully will help with hiring and retention. And then I saw a few things about trying to preserve our cash. It's tough to do everything, but I do think we have built up cash over the past 5 years, and but we've spent a lot over the past 1 year in things that were not budgeted, mainly the landfill, and we don't know what that will cost going forward too. So yeah, I saw some good stuff up there overall.
All right. Jean, go ahead with the next one. All right, so now we're getting ready to get into the meat of our budget discussions. Tonight we're going to talk about revenue that we're projecting throughout the city and how that's going to impact our budget planning process. So tonight's our first workshop. We'll discuss the process and schedule as we go through this presentation. We'll discuss the revenue items, our current debt service as we have it projected out through the next several years, capital funds, which include road infrastructure projects, fleet rotation, and facilities maintenance. So the budget part workshop process, the purpose is to receive feedback during the budget development process and to communicate where we are at this point in time. The budget remains a working document throughout the process based on historical data, trends, and projections. Format is for questions and comments. Public comment will be received at regularly scheduled city council meetings. Typically, our workshops do not include for public comment. That's usually reserved for our regularly scheduled city council meetings. So our schedule so far this year is March the 8th is our first, right now is our first budget workshop. Later this evening, you will hear from non-mandated outside agencies in the Bristol, Virginia Public Schools as far as their budget requests go. On Thursday evening at 6 p.m., you will hear department requests. We'll discuss salaries and benefits, and we'll also discuss the Solid Waste Disposal Fund. On April the 7th is the budget presentation. April 12th will be the City Council meeting where the City Council sets a tax rate resolution. I can tell you at this time, I do not anticipate an increase or decrease in tax rates at this time. April 26th, public hearing appropriation ordinance, public hearing on the appropriation ordinance. May the 10th would be the first reading of the budget ordinance, and May 24th is the second reading of the budget ordinance. So budgets. Pursuant to Virginia Code 15.2-2503, the governing body shall prepare and approve a budget for informative and fiscal planning purposes only, containing a complete, itemized, and classified plan of all contemplated expenditures and all estimated revenues and borrowings for the locality for the ensuing fiscal year. The itemized contemplated expenditures shall include any discretionary funds to be designated by individual members of the governing body and the specific uses and funding allocation plan for those funds by the individual member. So first, let's talk about revenues. And as I'm getting younger, my eyes are getting worse. We need to work on the size of this thing here, Gene. So our real estate current taxes in fiscal year 22, we budgeted, it's okay, I can get through it, Gene, maybe. Real estate current taxes, we budgeted this current fiscal year $12.57 million, and that is the same number we're going with this upcoming year, so no increase or decrease there. Real estate delinquent taxes, we left at $800,000. Current taxes on real property, this is DRI-1, so this is phase one of the falls, increase of about $16,200. Current taxes on real property in phases two and three of the falls, that's a decrease of $82,860, and that's just based on what we're actually seeing. Your PSC, current property taxes, a decrease of $2,500. Personal property current taxes, we left right at $3 million. Personal property delinquent taxes, we left at $300,000. And then PPTRA current taxes, we left at $723,000. Current taxes personal property within phase one, we increased that by $76,300, and that's based on what we're seeing happening in the DRI-1 at this time. Current taxes, personal property, DRI 2 and 3, we decreased by $2,150. Penalties, we left the same at $150,000. Interest, we left the same at $120,000. Tax administration fee, we left the same at $80,000. Local sales and use tax, and we've talked about this throughout the year. We have seen local sales and use taxes increased significantly, not only during COVID-19, but through this year as well. And we're trending towards $4.2 million, so we increased that by $350,000 this upcoming fiscal year. Consumer utility tax, we left the same at $155,000. Business license taxes, we saw an increase there, or seen an increase, and we've increased that by $170,000. Motor vehicle taxes, we increased by $10,000. Bank stock fees, we've decreased that by $70,000, and that's based on the fact that there is one less bank in the city of Bristol now than there was last year. Taxes on wills and recordation of wills, we left that the same at $150,000. Cigarette taxes, we've decreased by $35,000 to $440,000. Evidently, less people are smoking than what they used to, but that fluctuates, and we may see a big spike, and it really just depends on when the commissioner is buying those cigarette stamps throughout the city. But based on what we're seeing right now, we think $440,000 is a reasonable projection. Lodging tax, probably one of our biggest increases other than restaurant meals tax. And I think every quarter when Ms. Spradlin shows the charts of what our lodging and restaurant meals taxes do, she likes to point out, and she's 100% correct, that as lodging taxes increase, we also see restaurant meals tax increase. It's almost identical in that bar graph that she shows. It's really neat to watch. Anytime the lodging tax has gone down, so is restaurant meals tax. So based on what we're seeing, we are increasing lodging taxes to over $500,000 to $1.8 million. And we're increasing the restaurant meals tax by $1.1 million to $6.3 million. We've left the electric consumption tax the same at $67,000. The admissions tax, we've increased significantly to $33,500. However, prior to COVID-19, we typically had that at about $100,000, $110,000 in our budget. Once the pandemic hit, we zeroed that out, I believe, in spring of 20, knowing that the movie theaters and festivals and events were not occurring. And then this past year, we increased that a little bit because we anticipated the country opening up a little bit more, and we can see that that's happened. Restaurant meals taxes delinquent, we left that the same at $40,000. Local sales and use tax in the DRI, we increased by $25,000. Restaurant meals tax, DRI phase one, we increased that by $191,000. Business license tax in phase one, we increased by $8,900. Local sales and use tax in phase two and three of the falls, we increased by $46,000. And restaurant meals tax in the falls, we left the same at $155,000. Business license tax in phases 2 and 3, we left the same at $32,500. Interest on bank deposits, we decreased by almost 50%, maybe a little over 50%, simply because the city has entered into a new banking agreement with a local bank. The interest rates are different than what they were when we entered into our last agreement with a bank. So we had to account for that, and it was decreased by almost $71,000 in interest rates. Interest on investments, same situation. We decreased that to $16,000. That's almost a $38,000 decrease as well. State sales tax and DRI-1, we increased by $60,000. And in phases 2 and 3, we increased by $25,000. So revenue growth, here it is outlined so that you can see all the revenue growth throughout the city in each one of those line items. I won't go through those again, but that's just the breakdown of all the everything that has grown. And then here's the decreases, declining revenues is a little over $300,000 in declining revenues. So citywide debt, this is something that we talk about every single quarter when Ms. Bradlin presents the financial update, and this graph is always in part of her plan. You can see over the next 4 fiscal years, there is 0 additional funding needed to meet our debt service. In 26 and 27, we'll need an additional $291,000 of revenue to cover any increase in debt, and then in 27 and 28, an additional $800,000. So we have some time to make that up, but it's not something that we need to sit back on and hope that it just comes. We're going to have to work hard over the next 4 fiscal years to make sure that we can make that up and not have any issues moving forward with meeting our debt obligations. I do not foresee us having an issue with that, but we cannot rest on our laurels. Road and infrastructure projects. Now this one is, it's okay. You can see the list of projects that we have here better than I can. So fleet rotation, $480,000 this year. That's 4 police cars. That's a sheriff's vehicle, 1 fleet vehicle for the city, and a van for the IT department for them to maintain and carry equipment throughout the city as they maintain our IT services throughout the city. Other capital items. First, I'll say that this year we did not have a capital committee, and that's simply because there's 2 reasons. One, we have a position that is still unfilled at this time that is a significant part of that discussion with the Public Works Director. And then 2, mainly the capital items that we have in our capital plan, we're dealing with the jail. The vast majority of those capital items were expenses to renovate the jail if we were to keep the jail open. Based on what has transpired over the past year, it appears that the jail will be closing in the near future, and trying to discuss those plans at this time really would have proved fruitless because we don't anticipate needing those funds for any capital improvements at the jail. However, we are putting $100,000 into facilities maintenance in the capital project. That's throughout the city. And that's just for us to have funds available to take care of capital projects that may arise throughout the year if we need to replace a roof or something to that effect. And then also firefighter PPE. We have been putting this in the budget at a $30,000 line item in previous years, but due to the cost increase, that has now increased to $50,000 so that our firefighters have the protective equipment that they need as they fight fires. So what's next? Any questions that you all have, we will give you, we'll take those questions and research them and give you an answer within 1 week. We will continue to review the revenues based on new data as that rolls in throughout each month up until the budget presentation. And then we'll continue to assess it after the fact as well in case there's a major adjustment that needs to be required. And the next workshop is scheduled for Thursday night at 6 p.m. So I'm available for questions. If I can't answer them, I will. If I can't, we'll get back to you.
Can you go back to the slide about the road improvements? That one. Well, first, before we even get into it, thank you for this presentation. Thank you for all that you both do for this. So which of I noticed most of this is federally reimbursed. Are any of these, I see there's two that are marked new, but like we've been aware of the roundabout and the plan for the shared use path for a while. Are any of these federally funded through the infrastructure bill that passed through Congress?
None of these are. These have been funded previously.
Okay. So do we know about any of the, how that's going to work when the
Not
infrastructure money
time.
Comes? Well, I think this is a big win. You know, on that budget goals and priorities thing, I was the one talking about fixing the roads. And I think this is a big step. I mean, these are obviously, you know, main thoroughfares for the most part and big projects. And, you know, these will be a big benefit to the city.
I had a question, Vice Mayor, asked part of my question, but one, thank y'all for this presentation. I think that's amazing that you can spend 45,000 and change of local money to leverage over $7.3 million of state and federal money. That's really doing some good work and utilizing our local tax dollars to fix what you pointed out are desperate needs throughout the community. I guess my question partly too is a lot of these aren't new. Some, I know some of them we talk about and they get in BDOT and the smart scale and we know they're gonna get funded, but it seems like some of these projects just linger on and on and on and we put them in the budget and which is fine, but we end up at the next budget and either carry it forward or rebudget it. I mean, it would be nice to start moving through some of these in a quicker fashion, I guess.
Oh, I agree. And some of the issues that we've had with some of these projects, when they went out to bid this past year, the bids came back more than was anticipated by VDOT. And so they're going to have to put those out for rebid in order to attempt to get those numbers down to more to closely match what was budgeted for the project.
Yeah, and I can tell you that's a serious issue with any type of heavy construction project right now. I see that every day. What else was I going to ask? And I was going to ask, I'm glad the Vice Mayor brought that up about the Infrastructure Act. So have you received anything? Does it look like if maybe some of those funds can be used to make up the difference in because of inflation for some of these lingering projects, or have you seen any kind of guidance on that yet?
I have not seen any sort of guidance on this yet.
Okay.
I have one follow-up question that that made me think of it. And this is more tangential, you know, than what's specifically up here. I remember right before I took office in 2018, you all had a discussion about flattening the Exit 7 intersection.
Yes.
Like Clear Creek Road and all. I haven't heard anything else about that since then. What happened with that?
I hope I'm fired or retired by then. That will be a project that is that will create significant traffic issues when that happens. I believe that's funded through Smart Scale, if I'm not mistaken, and that project is probably another 4 to 5 years out.
Yeah, That was my recollection, is that it was that and the one of the roundabouts, I think it Euclid and Lee Highway.
Euclid and Lee Highway, that's right.
That one, both of those scored in the SMART scale, but that just means that somewhere in the next 6 years.
It's usually a 6 to 8 year process before those get funded. And you can see, which one is it here? One of those has 75,000 for the roundabout, the Lee Highway Euclid roundabout. And that's just in the preliminary phase of.
That's the engineering.
That's the engineering piece of that.
And this, they'll pick that up. We don't have to do that as a match.
Based on these numbers, we do not have to do any match on this right now.
That's good.
Not to get off subject from the budget in general, but that intersection at exit 7, is that the busiest intersection in
the
city?
It's the most dangerous intersection in the city. I think David McGee's maybe done an article or two on that intersection in the past about the number of accidents that occur at that intersection. And when that intersection was designed, I'm not exactly sure why it was designed the way it was, but it's something that VDOT recognized needed to be corrected based on the number of accidents, and that's what got it scored in order for it to be fixed.
I think there was even some discussions at one point about when it goes out for bid, the crew actually doing it, seeing if they could do it at night or something like that. I know it could be years down the road. But
yeah, I mean, I think for everybody's well-being, that probably project needs to be done at night due to the amount of traffic that travels through there from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. So that would be something we need to look at when that project comes online.
All right. So as more, if you could go back to the increases slide. There. Okay. And I know Ms. Spradlin presented a lot of kind of the increase with all of these that we could see: lodging, meals, admissions, sales tax. We're all this year increased above where you budgeted. So I guess my question is, and that's good that you're anticipating continued increase, are we back to about where we were pre-pandemic? Are these levels kind of have we kind of recovered from the pandemic about back to where we were?
The two that really stand out to me the most are your restaurant and lodging tax. Those are trending back to where we were pre-pandemic. Everything else is just basically based on whether or not a business is opened or closed in certain areas of the city, especially with the DRIs.
Yeah, and I guess what, I don't remember you said, but what is driving the business license tax?
Usually your business license is based on gross revenue.
Okay.
And so we can see based on the sales tax increase that probably people's gross revenue has increased, and that's what's driving that business license tax.
Okay. I've got more questions. If you go to the debt slide. And again, I appreciate this slide and knowing that we have a plan. We're not quite there yet, but I think it's a good solid plan. But I notice next year we don't have any money in the revenue sharing budgeted. And then the following year, I guess that agreement ends, so we recoup that savings, but we know that we're not paying out $350,000 right now. So are you just not accounting for that, or could we account for that and maybe use some of what we've received, if you haven't this year or next year, to help offset 2016 or 2026, 2027?
It's shown here because it will be available, but the entire 350 will be budgeted to still to the revenue sharing line item to keep it intact. If it's not all used, it may be available for a capital use or a one-time item, but our thoughts are to leave it there because we know in fiscal year 24 we're going to be using it.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was, and I think that's good. That's being very cautious, making sure, but I was just going to say, if you needed that, if we know we'll see some money back in revenue sharing, or we should. So take that and kind of drop it down and try to use this year and next year to start chipping away at the fiscal year 27 deficit. You see what I was saying?
I did.
And then that year would be taken care of, hopefully, or maybe. So.
All right, so I've got a question. It's about gas. So I think when we looked at our first budget calendar, gas was probably $3, and earlier I saw $4.15, and I don't know what it'll be in a month or 3 months or 6 months, but I guess a couple parts to this question. Our fuel that we use for our city vehicles, how we're looking at that, and then I guess too about our meals and lodging tax. I think, well, if I'm paying more for gas out of my own pocket, you know, only have so much income that I spend in a week or a month, so I may cut back and not eat out as much. So how do we feel about the projections for what we think we'll have in meals tax going
forward? I think what we need to do is continue to watch this throughout the budget process. As we've started to see gas prices increase, we may be able to tell if there's been a slowdown in meals tax and lodging tax over the next several months, specifically as the March numbers come in for February and then April for March. You know, I think it's going to be hard to project what's going to happen. I still think Americans feel good about traveling, even though it may be a little bit more expensive. We've got to remember that for basically 2 years, Americans were cooped up at home and they want to go back out and start enjoying America again. And hopefully they will continue to come to Bristol as they have been over the past year. So I think it's just something we're going to have to watch. And we have to remember too, the budget is a planning tool. It's not set in stone. And just like it happened in March of 20, as we were getting through the budget process, I think Ms. Spradlin and I almost had the budget complete, and then all of a sudden we had to reverse course and basically redo the budget again. Hmm. You know, there's a lot of uncertainty in the world right now, especially with Russia and Ukraine. We don't know how that's going to play out. Today, the House of Representatives, I think they passed a resolution to ban the import of Russian oil for America. Now, with that being said, Russian oil is only 8% of what's used in America. So is that going to have a tremendous impact on us? I couldn't tell you, but it appears the big oil companies in America have said that should not have an impact. And it seems like they've made some comments this afternoon that I read that they do not anticipate that would be a driving factor in the price of oil, but that's something yet to be seen.
Can you go back to the slide about the vehicle purchases? So, police cars, sheriff's vehicle, IT van. What's the fleet vehicle?
That's just one that's used throughout the city and fleet. That's for community development, for me, for anyone in the city. We need to roll at least one of those vehicles off and replace it.
Just a general purpose vehicle.
Just a general purpose vehicle.
Tying back in with the mayor's question about increasing gas prices, I know we buy through the state contract at the contracted rate. Are there any more fuel efficient vehicles you can get for the IT van and the fleet vehicle?
I'm sure we can look at that and see what's available. We haven't even started that process because it's not budgeted yet. And once we know that it's budgeted and in the budget, we can start looking at what types of vans would be out there that might be more gas friendly.
That may be beneficial if, you know, if we continue to see gas prices as we've seen them, you know.
Keeping on the subject of the vehicles, how are we on the stuff in the collections regarding the leaf truck and the truck that picks up the branches?
At the moment, there has not been a need, and it appears that most of that equipment is working appropriately. I can tell you, as we went through the budget with each one of the departments, we did ask each department if they had any capital needs, based on the fact that we knew we didn't have a capital committee this past year. And any capital needs that were mentioned, we are putting in the budget if we can afford it, and if not, we will roll to that next year.
With the police cars, I know a few years ago we moved to this to try to pay for them a certain number each year and get into a rotation and get away from the capital leases. Have we pretty well done that, or are we still working through
that process? No, we've still got a significant way to go. I think we've probably got four more budget cycles, probably, until we get maybe more than that.
We're actually close on the general fund.
On the...
Okay.
On the leases, yes, okay.
Yeah, yeah, because I know that it takes a while to cycle through there, and that's where I was, didn't know how, if we kind of got there yet, or we still had a couple of years.
So we're purchasing these, right?
Yes,
we're not actually...
We're not leasing.
Yeah.
That's good.
That's something Ms. Spradlin instituted back in spring of 18 to roll us off leases, and that's what we need to do.
That's a good step, yeah.
On the subject of that, for the vehicles, and you talk about the fleet rotation, do we do that, like, just out of curiosity, every 100,000 miles, or?
Well, we have a really good fleet maintenance department. So David McConnell is excellent as he keeps up with our vehicles, and I could call David right now and ask him about a specific vehicle. I guarantee you he could tell me the last time the oil was changed, when the tires were changed, and what's wrong with the vehicle. David is very good in telling us when we need these vehicles serviced. I can tell you police cars typically roll out at about 100,000 miles, or they should roll out at about 100,000 miles. When I first came on board, we had many vehicles with well over 100,000 miles being used by our police officers, and were breaking down and causing significant issues. That has changed now. They actually have good police cars, and you know, there are a few out there that need to be replaced, but this will be part of that process. Mm-hmm.
So essentially the four oldest, the four, say, worst ones are roll off when these new four ones come
online. That's correct. All right. Well, if there's no further questions, we can stop here. I can stand here for another 24 minutes.
Does anyone have any other questions for tonight? And just to confirm, the next... one is
Thursday night, 6 p.m.
Okay. All right. Any more questions? We'll go ahead and adjourn this called meeting.